the shore, hold me close, sway me more. Like a flower bending in the breeze, bend with me, sway with ease. So when you dance, you have to bear with me, stay with me, sway with me. Other dancers may be on the floor, dear, but my eyes will see only you. Only you have that magic technique. When we sway, I go weak. I can hear the sound of violins long before it begins. Make me thrill as only you know how. Sway me smooth, sway me. Other dancers may be on the floor, dear, but my eyes will see only you. Only you have that magic technique. When we sway, I go weak. I can hear the sound of violins long before it begins. Make me thrill as only you know how. Sway me smooth. When marimba rhythms start to play, dance with me, make me sway. Like a lazy ocean hugs the shore, hold me close, sway me more. Like a flower bending in the breeze, bend with me, sway with me. When we dance, you have a way with me, stay with me. Sway with me. When marimbas start to play, hold me close, make me sway. Like an ocean hugs the shore, hold me close, sway me more. Like a flower bending in the breeze, bend with me, sway with me. When we did, you have a way with me.
That's it. How easy is that?
What's impossible, they forgot. This world keeps spinning, and with each new day, I can feel a change in everything. And as the surface breaks, reflections fade. But in some ways, they remain the same. And as my mind begins to spread its wings, there's no stopping curiosity. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance to Mother Nature's songs. I don't want this feeling to go away. I can't do everything, well, I can try. And as I roll along, I begin to find things aren't always just what they seem. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance to my
please don't go away. Please don't go away. Please don't go away. Is this how it's supposed to be? Is this how it's supposed to be?
Thank you.
1 minute. Just a little reminder, please be sure to log in so you'll have full access to the bidding. We'll see everything in real time because we are live. Yes, we are. If you see your name at the top of the screen, the top of the bidding screen, that means you are logged in. You're ready to go. If not, make sure that you hit get started, and we will start in just 1 second. Good evening, everybody. Welcome. I see all of you. Welcome to SF Casa's Fostering Change Virtual Gala. So wonderful to have you all with us tonight. Futures in Bloom, because that's what we're hoping to do, to help our youth bloom in their future. You're making it happen by your giving and your generosity. And I'm so honored to be your host. I'm Leah Maitland, been with CASA now for about 12 years. I know so many of you have as well. So thank you for being with us, and thank you for giving up a big part of your Friday night. And friends, tonight you'll hear from two youth who will join us to share their story of what having a CASA has meant to them. You'll also hear from a CASA volunteer reflecting on his experiences. You'll have a chance to bid on some very exciting auction packages, and they really are exciting, including, you know, friends, I've been waiting for this moment all week, this massive 9-liter, can you see this? Can you see this right here? It's a 9-liter, there we go. Look at that. It's a 9-liter Salmanazar. What is the Salmanazar? Well, it's a 9-liter bottle of wine. That's my workout for the day. So, ooh, right over there. Friends, here's the deal. The winner of that will be set to host your first post-pandemic party. You'll invite the entire neighborhood. If the bottle is too big for you, don't worry. We also have a rare vertical of Kosta Browne Sonoma Coast Pinot, 3 magnums, 2017, 2018, 2019. That Pinot is a party on your palate, let me tell you. And for those eager to get away, and I know we all want to get away somewhere, check out our travel packages. You can head to Costa Rica, Aloha Hawaii, or anywhere Alaska Airlines flies for a 5-night luxury vacation. And here's the good news. We're going to fly you there, and we're going to bring you back. Yes, not just a one-way ticket, round trip. And you get to choose where you want to go from one of those luxury stays. A few logistics to go over with you. If you see your name at the top of this page, that means you're ready to start bidding and making donations. Thank you for that. If you're not already logged in, click on the Get Started button. That's on the bidding screen. There you can register your credit card, and you can bid on anything and make donations directly from your screen. It's pretty simple. We hope. However, your card, here's the good news, will not be charged until Monday. So if you'd like to pay another way, you can. You can send an email to our Maggie. That's maggie@sfcasa.org. That's maggie@sfcasa.org. Or you can call or text to this number, 415-322-0398. That's 415. It's there on the screen too. 322-0398. If you're having trouble registering, you can call that same number. We have a team. They're all sitting, waiting eagerly to take your call. We'll keep that number on the bottom of the screen all night in case you need to use it for whatever reason. And now, excuse me, before I introduce our first speaker, in case you missed it, I have an exciting announcement, and I wish we had a drum roll. Can we pretend we have a drum roll in the house? Here we go. Drum roll, please. The drums go wild. We have a match. All contributions tonight up to a total of $200,000, which is, I mean, come on, let's make some noise in the room here, everybody. Woo! Yes! Make some noise at home as well, a $200,000 match. That means that we get to double your impact, double your giving with every dollar, dollar for dollar, up to $200,000. Now, our overall goal for the gala is $800,000 tonight. So we still have a ways to go, another $170,000 to raise, no pressure, but I know we can do it. So friends, whether you give $20,000 or $20, your gift will be doubled thanks to our generous, very generous volunteer. Please enjoy the gorgeous spread from our restaurant partner. I know many of you already have or are enjoying it now, from our friends at A16. And of course, that comes with a delicious bottle of Hagen Cabernet. Now, I understand all of the SF CASA board members are joining us tonight. So hello to the board. Where would we be without you? And a few of the board members want to say hello. Let's take a look.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm Lisa Pearson, the board chair for San Francisco CASA. We would have loved to have everyone together in one room tonight, but we are thrilled that you are here. Thank you for supporting San Francisco CASA, and thank you for supporting our youth. We are incredibly grateful.
Hi, I'm Sally. I'm honored to be a board member for SF CASA. I'm here with my daughter Kiki tonight, and we can't wait to kick off this auction and celebrate all the great work that's done at SF CASA. Big shout out to my friends around Marin County, the East Bay, San Francisco. We're all here pulling for you tonight and hope to have a fabulous event. Thanks so much.
Hi, this is Jim Markman, and I am so excited to be celebrating with you here tonight in support of San Francisco Foster Youth and SF CASA.
Hi, I'm Erwin, a board member at SF CASA. I'm so excited to be here tonight celebrating with friends and supporting foster youth in San Francisco. It's great to see our community come together for such a great cause.
Hi, I'm Kunal, one of the newest board members at SF CASA. I feel so fortunate to be able to share an evening with a community of people dedicated to learning about and supporting such an essential organization. Our mission could not be achieved without you.
Also incredibly engaged, also inspiring. You may recall last time we were together in person, Lisa Pearson co-chaired the gala. It was on this very day, exactly 2 years ago. Well, now I couldn't be more thrilled to introduce to you San Francisco CASA's new executive director. Her name is Kate Durham. She's lovely. You're going to love her. So Kate just started in March. She comes to us with vast experience working with foster youth and other vulnerable youth in San Francisco and the East Bay. So let's give a huge warm welcome, friends, to Kate. Kate, come on in here. The floor is yours, Kate.
Thank you so much, Liam. We are so grateful to have you as part of the San Francisco CASA family. Hi, everyone. I am so thrilled to have joined the team at San Francisco CASA. It is a privilege to work on behalf of an organization that approaches its work with young people with such heart, integrity, and intention. From my first meeting, I've been truly impressed by how committed and passionate the board is. Many have been CASAs, and all of them are deeply committed to our mission and to supporting our long-term sustainability and impact. Thank you. I also want to thank our amazing staff and our 350 volunteer CASAs who together form the heartbeat of our work. And finally, I want to thank our lead sponsors this evening, our Hibiscus sponsor Gilead and Peony hosts Michelle Griffin and Tom Parker. Thank you for leading the way with your generosity. For many years, I've seen the power of the CASA model and its ability to transform the lives of vulnerable children and youth. And among CASA programs, San Francisco CASA is a true leader in training and supporting youth-centered, strength-based, trauma-informed, social justice-oriented advocates committed to lifting children and youth voice, choice, and potential. Every child entering foster care has experienced some amount of trauma. If nothing else, removal from his, her, or their home and placement into foster care is in and of itself traumatic. One of the most important factors in overcoming trauma and building identity and ultimately thriving is the support of consistent, caring adults. We all want a sense of belonging. We all want to know that we matter. So the CASA model, one CASA for every young person in care, strikes at the heart of what it means to be in foster care and what youth need to succeed. Our CASAs, at first glance, everyday, ordinary people, are actually superheroes. They are consistent, they are kind, they are trustworthy, they are authentic, they are culturally humble, they are curious, and they help kids heal. For the last month, I've been going through our CASA training with our new class of 40 prospective volunteers, and I've been so inspired by our trainees, the training team, the approach of our training, and the emphasis we put on building trusting relationships above all else. For the past year, my wife and I have supported our 17-year-old daughter to navigate her fear and anxiety arising from COVID, the prevalence of violence against Black and Brown people, the devastating wildfires, and social isolation while trying to maintain some academic momentum during remote schooling. This has been a hard year for all young people, but imagine being a 10 or 12 or 14 or 18-year-old and not having a familiar support system, to suddenly be living among strangers with no familiar arms holding you and guiding you through these multiple and at times terrifying crises. During this past year, our more than 300 volunteer advocates jumped into action. They delivered groceries and cleaning supplies. They dropped off meals. They secured medical care and mental health counseling. They checked in, they followed up, and they cared. For many young people, it was their CASA who supported them through remote learning. CASAs worked relentlessly to find laptops, phones, iPads, and Wi-Fi hotspots to keep youth connected to their classes, and they stayed in touch with their teachers to make sure young people didn't fall through the cracks. Young people in care interact with a lot of adults, attorneys, social workers, judges, foster parents, teachers, but their CASA is often the one adult in the mix who isn't paid to support them. In their special role, CASAs often pay attention to things that other people miss. This matters. This opens the door for healing. A CASA's role is to get to know the young person, build on their strengths, invest in their superpowers, amplify their voice, and advocate for their interest in the rooms that matter, whether that be the courtroom or the classroom. I like to think that CASAs hold up mirrors to reflect young people's goodness and their innate potential and promise. I believe that CASAs hold up these mirrors until young people can see for themselves what their CASA sees in them. That's the genesis of this year's theme, Futures in Bloom. Our role is not to save youth and not to define what success means for them, but to guide their exploration, their development, and make sure they have the supports they need so they may bloom into their best selves. I'm so excited for you to hear from our Dynamic Youth speakers tonight, so I'm gonna stop here. I'd like to introduce Veronica Zelaya, an accomplished young woman who generously comes back to CASA every few months to talk with our trainees about what they can expect and share her perspective as a former foster youth. Please join me in welcoming Veronica.
Good evening. My name is Veronica Zelaya, and I want to share a couple of moments with you about my life. I am of Salvadoran descent and grew up in the Tenderloin and Hunters Point most of my life. When I was 9 years old, I was living in San Mateo and got taken away from my family. I ran away from my house to go to school because school felt safe for me, and from that day on, my life changed. I moved to East Palo Alto and met my first foster mother, Miss Rosetta Augman. It was also different for me. Different city, different culture, different food, different values, but I felt like it was the best thing that ever happened to me. My birth mother was battling with substance abuse and couldn't take care of me. Luckily, I had my father, Gabriel, who was there for me. He'd come and drop off food at school. He would come to every court date and show up to our family visits, even when my mom didn't. My dad was funny, a gentle giant, protective, hardworking. He was the embodiment of love and has so much compassion for others. My dad really wanted me back home and did everything the courts asked him to do to make sure that I came back home. However, the courts gave my dad a really hard time because he was not my biological father. He still showed up for me. He gave me the strength to get through foster care because that was such a scary time for me. My mom finally got her act together and really worked hard to get clean and got me back, so I ended up moving back to San Francisco when I was 11 years old. Barely a year later, I was placed back into foster care, and this time things were different. The first time around, I had my own room, and my foster mom, Roro, was gentle but firm. This time I was placed in a home with five other girls, little supervision and feeling like I was left to survive by myself. As a teenager, I was in four foster homes and each was different. I lived with seven other girls in one and five in another, all with their own traumas and experiences. I learned that foster care as a teenager is about survival. It's about proving that you're not to be messed with, and I made a vow that I would never show a sign of weakness. And that's why I got into so much trouble. I wasn't going to school, disrespecting teachers, fighting everybody, and looking for love in the wrong places. Dr. G gave me a really hard time. I was late to her class, and then her first thing was, hanging around with your friend, you're gonna be pregnant just like her. Because I was wearing teenage stuff. I was trying to show my skin a little more going into my girly stage. And she basically was like, I was gonna be, 16 and pregnant. And I remember throwing a book at her because I felt disrespected. And it came from it just triggered me because my mom used to say stuff like that to me anytime I dressed girly or anything. And I really didn't like it. And I felt disrespected by it. During this time, it was also very hard for me to trust anyone. Between my third and fourth foster home, I was placed in a shelter after running away, and I remember thinking to myself, like, man, I really hope I don't go into a group home, because I had heard from other foster youth that it was like jail. That's when I met my mama Doe. And the first thing that she asked me was, you hungry? And I left the shelter and I never looked back. One Cesar Chavez day, I was waiting to meet my new CASA volunteer, and I was excited because I had CASAs before this one, and my CASAs always took me out to eat. I kind of knew what to expect from this new CASA. There was a knock on the door, and instead of my CASA, it was a police officer. They handcuffed me and put me in the back of the police car. As I was sitting in the back of the police car, I saw Kate from the window talking to my foster mom, Mama Doe, and I heard her yell out, I'm following you there. In my mind, I'm like, damn, I'm about to scare this lady off. Kate followed us there, but I waited a couple of days in juvenile hall before I was able to see her. She brought my grandma and my birth mom to see me. Though she was a stranger, Kate made a way for my family to be there. I had planned to meet Kate over some food, but we met in jail instead. I instantly connected to her. No one had ever shown up for me like that. She was always on Team Veronica. Whether it was coming to all of my IEP meetings, rewarding me for doing my homework, with getting my nails done, or supporting my music career, Kate shared new experiences with me. If I didn't know something, she taught me, and I never felt ashamed because of it. When I got older, Kate supported me by coming to events I was in, such as open mics, showcases, and would financially support my nonprofit projects. I work for a nonprofit. It's called Sunset Youth Services, and I am a creative specialist. I've been there for 2 years now. So Sunset Youth Services and Upstart Records is like the same thing, but it's a youth-run record label that's at Sunset Youth Services, and that's basically what we like manage. But we're more than just like music. It's like a big old family, and it's Sunset Youth Services is like a big old house where you come and eat, you come and like get services for like your family. Like if you're a young mom, they have services for you. If you're like homeless, we get you connected to somebody with like family services. It's like case management, and we work with kids from 14 to 24, which super close to my age at the time when I got hired. And that's honestly what I was scared of, because I was like, man, why would they take orders for me? Like, you know, I didn't want to come in it like I'm like a boss or anything, because I know that kids or youth or young people like me come from traumatic backgrounds and they have certain triggers and all of that. So it was a lot that I was thinking of before, you know, before I got the job. I was just afraid that I would fail at it, but honestly, I fit right in. It's not an easy job, you know. You lose kids to violence, to overdoses, all kind of stuff. Things that, it's like real issues out here. So, but I decided to do this work because, not because I want to save anybody, but I just like, I feel like I'm a product of my community. Like that, there's a saying that people would say, like, it takes a village to raise a child, and I feel like I'm the product of that. Like, I was always a part of something, like if it was the DJ project or my EAP or it was something, like I was always trying to find family and something because of, you know, my messed up background. And I just wanted to be that for somebody like me, you know, because I feel like I decided to, like, I always say, like, I'm on the other side now, you know, like I grew up in survival, but now I'm on the other side, and I just want to, like, show kids that, like, you can be on the other side, you know, and you are always gonna have, like, healing to do, and it's okay. And I just wanna, like, create spaces for, like, people like me. So I'm 25 years old, and my case still checks up on me, still helps me financially if needed, which I try not to ask because I love being independent, but I know I have someone in my corner. Kate definitely plays that unconditional love role in my life. We may not see each other as much now, but I'm an adult finding my way, and she's creating her own family, but she never makes me feel like I'm not a part of her life, and I'm thankful for that. It feels good to know that I mean something to somebody without any conditions. I say all this to say that having Kate is the biggest blessing for someone like me, the ones that I've forgotten about.
Our thanks to Veronica for sharing her most personal story. Another future in bloom right there. We also want to thank Veronica's CASA, Kate, who shared with us just the reward that she gets from being Veronica's CASA. It's a two-way street, but often for the CASA, the reward is just as great, if not greater. And now we want to share another story by another one of our youth who currently has a CASA. Let's hear Maria's story.
It's Maria Hernandez. I have been a part of the foster system since I was 15 years old. I am currently 18 years old and gonna turn 19 next month. So I'm gonna start off by telling you guys a little bit of my background story. I was in the sixth grade when I got home and found my dad upset. He kicked me out of my house, threw all my clothes out, and told me to not come back. Before that, I had to grow up very fast because things were not easy, even before getting kicked out of my house. My family and I moved a lot. The first time was when my mom decided to leave my dad. She left to LA and my dad decided to follow her because he was very heartbroken. At the time, it was just me and my younger brother, Jose. I remember not understanding the situation and I was very confused. We lived in LA for about a year and everything was so calm normal. I went to school and my parents weren't fighting as much. And it seemed like they were getting along even better. Then we moved back to the Bay Area. We had nowhere to live and stayed at my family's for a few months. My dad eventually got a job as a hotel manager and we moved into the hotel. It was a very small space that I shared with my mom, my dad, and my little brother, Jose. During the time, my mom was also pregnant with my little brother, Felix. She had a very rough pregnancy. My dad would hurt her physically and emotionally because he was always under the influence. When my baby brother was born, my life changed even more. My mom had to stay in the hospital because she had postpartum depression, and I was in charge of both of my siblings. So I was a mom for them since the age of 10. My dad was always busy, so-called working, but mainly drinking with his friends. There were good times when he would take us to the park and spend time with us, but that was only when he was sober. Once my mom came back, it was as if nothing had changed. She was always on her medication, so she was never really there. I still had to protect my siblings from all the yelling and hitting. I didn't want them to see that as kids. My parents were constantly fighting and arguing, and my mom had started drinking, and she was always angry. It was in the middle of this drinking and fighting when my dad kicked me out. At this point, I had learned to be independent and very hard-headed, so I left, not looking back. My heart was broken. I've always been a daddy's girl, but what he did to me made me hate him and not want to talk to him. It was around 10 p.m. I was walking in the streets, wondering where to go. Luckily, I had a really good friend and her mom who let me stay at their place. As the days passed, he kept looking for me and trying to apologize and said I was his world and he would never do that again. But I wondered, why did it happen to begin with? It was rough. It was tough for me to stay mad at my dad because all of the good memories I had with him took over the bad ones, regardless of what had occurred. A few years passed. In the eighth grade, my mom and siblings were living in a transitional housing. My dad lived in his car for a few months, but he always managed to make time for us to take us to the park and take me to school. Because he showed up for me, my relationship with him got better, but my relationship with my mom got worse and worse. We were constantly arguing, and it was hard for us to see each other. But my dad was the glue in our family. He could prevent fighting between us, and then one day he just stopped showing up. No more coming to my soccer games. A month passed, and he would call me but never told me where he was. And then I found out he left for Mexico without saying goodbye. This was very hard for me because I was very close to my dad and I went into depression. We moved again and this time to Treasure Island. My mom was always gone, and when she was home, she behaved in a way that affected my brothers. They started to talk back to her and call her names. They no longer had respect for her. Then came the roughest time for me, December 24th. I received a phone call from my godmother telling me that the police had arrested my mom and my brothers had gotten taken away. I fell to the ground crying, not knowing what to do. The first thing I could think of was reaching out to my family. 2 days later, my mom was released. I didn't want to see her nor talk to her. I was trying so hard to get information on where my brothers were, but the social workers wouldn't give me any. I finally went to see my little brother. I felt joy and peacefulness hugging them, but I knew it wouldn't last. When the visit ended and they were taking them out of the room, my little brother Felix ran to me. I said, "Sister, don't let them take us. We want to go home with you." This broke my heart because I knew I couldn't do anything. And this is when I decided I was going to do good in school and be successful for my brothers. The first time I was assigned to CASA was my 8th grade year. She was a very nice woman and we would go out to places to eat and talk. But it was hard for me to open up to her. Although she would take me out, I didn't feel a connection with her. At this time, I was a lot younger and immature. I personally think I wasn't ready for that relationship. Then I got Esther appointed by the court to be my CASA, and we have been working together for the past 3 years. When I first met Esther, I was worried about not connecting with her because it has always been hard for me to open up to new people. I was scared and nervous about opening up to her because I wasn't sure if I was going to feel comfortable. However, once I got to know her and how she respected whether I wanted to share my past with her or not, it just made me feel like I could trust her. Once I got to know her, I felt like I had a free space to talk and speak my mind without being judged. Esther came into my life at a rough time. In many ways, I lost both my mom and dad, and I was feeling alone and felt angry all the time. I was still struggling with my family because I was unable to visit my brothers. To this day, Esther continues to push my social worker and lawyer to help me and make my visits possible. She also helped me get things done that I needed. For example, my passport, my driving permit, and my ID. My CASA is not only my CASA, she is also a friend who listens to me when I need to vent and a huge support system when I'm feeling mad or sad. I am a senior this year and I was having a very hard time getting motivated for school because of my situation with my brothers. I also miss my parents and it's hard to focus with all this on my mind. Esther kept me motivated by checking in on me and speaking with me about my schoolwork. Earlier in the school year, she helped me fill out my FAFSA and has helped me reach out to my social workers for scholarship opportunities. With her support, I've been accepted into SF State. She has helped me make my dream about going to college possible. Esther has helped me become the person I am today, and she has been a guidance for me and a reminder that I need to keep pushing myself no matter what. I am very thankful for CASA because having a CASA has changed my life. I wish all children could have a CASA.
Oh, thanks to Maria. Thank you so very much for sharing your personal story. Each and every year we hear from our foster youth, we're all moved in the room and we're all moved tonight. So we thank them all for being so personal and so honest and brave in sharing their story. It's not an easy one. And I stand here tonight as your MC, but also as a former foster kid growing up in Ireland and England. And During a really challenging time of my childhood, my brother Rory and I, we were fostered. And then later, I had a CASA. His name was Clive, and he steered me on the straight and narrow for the most part. He helped me find my passion, which was a microphone and broadcasting, helped me get into college and then onto a career with the BBC. So thank you, Clive, and thank you all the CASAs. Without you, I wouldn't be here tonight. And I know so many of our youth, our kids, would not be in the path that they are on had they not had a CASA. This work is so incredibly important. It is near and dear to me. I get this work. I know this work. I know you do as well. So we thank you for showing up tonight. And for our youth and our CASAs, I'm giving you all a big hug of love for the magic that you deliver and bring. Thank you. That said, folks, it is now a really important part of the evening. Yes, it is the fun part. It's the fundraising part, and we're hoping that everyone will be willing to participate. So this is the moment where I'm going to ask you to dig deep. This is the moment I'm going to ask you to think about the CASAs and the work that they are doing with our youth. This is the moment to really make a difference in the lives of our youth, to be change makers. And not just think of the youth, but think of the ripple effect. When you help that youth, they have a CASA, and who they then go out into the world to be. This is the moment we get to make that difference for our youth. So the idea is that we train more Kates and more Esters so we can eventually get to the goal of serving all youth, each and every youth in foster care. Imagine that, every youth having a CASA, one-on-one. That's our goal. We want to get there, and we're on the march. So tonight, our goal, it's a lofty one, to raise $800,000. And thanks to you, your generosity, your giving, tonight we just have to raise $170,000. Come on, everyone in the room, let's make a little noise. Here we go. We can do this. Yes, we can. Yes, we can, and we will. I know we can do this together. So, folks, you know how it works. Just click on the Donate Fund a Future button. Follow the prompts on your screen. And remember, every gift tonight will be doubled because of that generous match. We told you about it earlier tonight. We have a $200,000 match. So your giving will be doubled. Your dollar for dollar matched will double your giving, double your impact, and get us on the march to our goal. So, friends, we always love to go big. I think Michelle Obama said, when they go low, we go high. Well, in the fundraising world, we start high and we go low. So $20,000, a gift of $20,000 will help us recruit, screen, and support a class of 40 new advocates to match with 40 youth waiting for a CASA of their own. Imagine that, that gift at $20,000. So thank you, Travis Pearson. Thank you, Steve White. Thank you so much for your generosity at the $20,000 level. If anyone else would like to jump in at that level, I know it's a big one. It's a big ask. I'm asking you tonight to be audacious in your giving. If you can find it in your heart to jump in there. Listen, this past year, I know I haven't been traveling. I haven't been to a concert. I have spent some money on wine. I was going to say I didn't. But, you know, we've all saved a little money this year, some of us. And so if you're feeling generous, consider our youth, because it is our youth that you're helping tonight. So $20,000, that's where we're kicking off tonight. I want to thank a couple of our donors just in. So Lisa and Travis Pearson, we thank you for kicking off at the $20,000 mark. Come on, let's make some noise in the room, everybody. Here we go. And thank you to Lisa and Travis Pearson. Again, we thank you. Steve White, we thank you, Steve, so very, very much. Anyone else at the $20,000 level? By the way, every dollar counts. Every donation matters. Whatever you can give, there's only one way to give. I always say this, and that is to give from the heart. If it feels good, hit that donate button. And when your head hits the pillow tonight, you're going to feel extra good. You'll sleep extra well because of the difference you're making for our foster youth. All right, friends, let's move on to our next level of giving, the $10,000 level. You can support 10 youth who have special education needs with a specially trained volunteer able to make educational decisions on their behalf. That's a gift at the $10,000 level. So imagine that. That's the price of a meal at the French Laundry. Consider a donation instead. So let's thank a few friends right here who've already jumped in at $10,000. Thanks so much to Jim Watson, And also to Jan and Jim Watson, thank you. And of course, they are one of our founders, Jan and Jim. We thank you so very much. Thank you also to Greg Merva, a gift of 10,000. And thank you to Chloe Sugarman. Come on, make some noise in the room here. Another $10,000. We thank you. I see all the gifts groaning. We're going to keep the giving going. Our idea tonight, of course, is to have the thermometer right behind me here, this thermometer right here, to see this go all the way to the tippy top. We want to see that literally explode through the screen right there. So as the donations come, the thermometer is going up and up and up. It's so wonderful. So our next level of giving, friends, look at that. I love it. The numbers are rising. I'm going to give some shout outs as we go tonight. But our next level of giving tonight will support a youth for a full year as they graduate high school. That's a gift of $5,000. It'll help that youth prepare for college and a career, build a community of support, and prepare for adulthood. So your gift of $5,000. Let's see if we have any gifts at that level, at the $5,000 level. And remember, we're still matching dollar for dollar. So your $5,000 right now is actually $10,000 because of the match. Jen Taylor and Jessica Tomlinson, we thank you. Allison and Jesse Eisenhart, we thank you. Vicky Valandra and Peter Kelly, we thank you. Another gift just in. Kristen Wolf, another gift. $5,000, everybody. And look at our thermometer rising. We're almost at the $500,000 mark tonight. This feels so good. It feels good to give. Keep the generosity going, everybody. Thank you also at the $5,000 level to Betsy and Roy Eisenhart. Thank you. Kelechi Ozumele, thank you. Andrew Mayer, thank you. Nancy Sparrow and Norm Brand, we thank you. Jamel and Tom Perkins, thank you. Sally Starks, thank you. And also to Toma Brava, we thank you so much. A gift right there of $5,000. And friends, just remember, we're so close right here to the $500,000 mark. We're going to keep that thermometer rising. We still have that $200,000 match. Every donation you make right here, right now, we're going to match it so your impact is doubled. Your giving is doubled. So our next level of giving, friends, is the $2,500 level. And this will help one of our youth find a forever home, a forever home for a foster child. I've been there, not knowing where that home is going to be. And as a kid, all you want is consistency. All you want is a place to call home. So at the $2,500 level, thank you, Gail and Bernie Nebenzahl. We thank you. Liza Spinali, or Lisa, thank you. Marcy Pattinson, thank you. Catherine Rockwell, thank you. Allison and Jesse Eisenhart, we thank you. Becca Katz and Andrew Smith, thank you. Jen and Jamie Young-Perlman, thank you. Carol Freidenberg, thank you. Marsha Rosenbaum, Ted Briggs and Ted Jarvis, thank you. Jessica and Eric Sparley, the $2,500 level. The thermometer is rising, 530. Come on, everybody in the room, here we go. This is so wonderful. Let's keep the thermometer rising. We've got to keep that going. The more we raise tonight, the more CASAs we'll have for our youth. Our goal, one day, every foster youth has a CASA, one-on-one. So as your gifts keep on coming in tonight, we still have that match. And next, the $1,000 level, as we help futures bloom, you're going to help guide a foster youth as they identify and pursue their passions. So that includes visiting a college, the next step for our youth, when they're thinking about a career, maybe extracurricular activities. If you can just dig deep and think about that gift of $1,000, we appreciate it so much. Eamon Foley, thank you. Lawrence Rockwell, thank you. Maureen Caru, thank you. Laurie Vroom, thank you. Corinne and David Chamberlain, thank you. And also at the $1,000 level, thanks to Morrison and Foster, we thank you so very, very much. I love seeing the numbers tick. That means the giving is great. And friends, it's about to get even better because the Quest Foundation has offered to match every gift right now at the $1,000 level up to $35,000. So if we can get 35 people right now, we can unlock that match. 35 at 1,000. And we just had one come in. Thank you to Suki O'Connor. Suki, thank you very much for your gift of 1,000. More gifts coming in. Kathy Raphael, thank you. Jack Hoffman, thank you. Judge Michael Beggett, thank you. Every single dollar matters, folks. And remember, we have that match. We're matching dollar for dollar. So whatever you give, this level, 1,000 right here, right now, that becomes 2,000 because we are doubling your impact. Kelly Wright just in with another gift of $1,000. For that, we thank you so very, very, very much. Let's keep the giving going, everybody. The more you give, the more CASAs we will get to our foster youth. To Kristen Moach, thank you, Kristen. Another gift. Come on, everybody in the room, make some noise at the $1,000 level. We thank you, friends. And if you're sitting there and you're thinking about whether or not you should hit that donate button, don't think anymore. Hit the donate button. Now is the moment. Now is the moment to show up for our foster youth. You know, we are funding the future, and they are the future. Our youth right here in the Bay Area, and you have an opportunity right now to really have an impact on that. So, next up, friends, let me tell you one more thing. Every child who gets a personal medical attention for a gift at the $1,000 level, that's another thing I just wanted to add to that, by the way. We also have a few more thank yous. So, we want to thank another giver, another donor right here. Are we going to keep on going with it? Or we hit the mark? We did it. Friends, the $200,000 match, we did it. Make some noise in the room. Thank you so very, very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. But friends, we still have that $1,000 match. Up to $35,000. So if we can get a few more people at the $1,000 level, we're going to match you dollar for dollar. Pauline Lay just came in. Pauline, thank you for your gift of $1,000. We thank you so very, very much. I'm taking a little look at the board behind me right here. Look at that, 777. Friends, we are doing so incredibly well. You're making it happen. You're getting us close to our goal. We could not do this without you. To all our casters watching tonight, we thank you. And this is for you. It's also for the kids. It's, of course, first and foremost, it's for the kids. So let's keep the giving going, everybody. Our next level of giving tonight, here we go. Our next level of giving tonight is the $500 level. That will ensure a foster child gets the personal medical attention they need. So imagine that, you know, a young kid, medical care, crucial, all important, and $500 a gift at that level. So consider that. And again, we hit the first match, so that first match is gone, but we still have an opportunity to match at $1,000. Margaret Keane, Margaret, thank you very much. We just got your gift of $1,000, and for that we thank you. Your $1,000 becomes $2,000. We thank you so very, very much. So at the $500 level, I love to see the thermometer rising. That means we're raising money. That means we're going to be close to hitting our goal. So we thank you. At the $250 level, Keenan Amy and William Claster, we thank you. Brooke Papiri, we thank you. And Mike Bambrick, we thank you. Kimberly and Jonathan Garfinkel, we thank you. Kathleen Linner, Joan Levison, Ruth Herring, Judges Donna Hitchens and Nancy Davis, we thank you so very, very much. Helen Hilton Razor, Deirdre Curry, Anu Manan, and Akash Garg, we thank you at the $500 level. And now, our next level of giving, $250. Friends, here's what $250 will do for our youth tonight. It will help a foster youth learn a new sport or maybe a musical instrument. We're talking about extracurricular activities, maybe even summer camp. You know, this is so crucial. A kid just wants to feel like they are a kid and get out there and enjoy some activities, especially now that they're about to be able to do that once again. So please consider a donation at $250. Right now, hit the donate button. Let's do it. Here we go. Thank you. Brian Jaffe, we thank you. Sarah Scripp, thank you. William Pollock, thank you. Bianca Gates, thank you. Friends, every single donation matters. Every dollar counts. So whatever you can give, we appreciate your giving so very, very, very much. Now, friends, a couple more board members want to say hello. So let's go to them for a little moment. Come back in just a bit with more giving. Take a look.
Hi, I'm Catherine, a board member at SF CASA, and I'm so appreciative of all the friends, family, and community members who've come together tonight to support and celebrate SF CASA's work. We couldn't do it without you.
Hi, I'm Brinley. I'm a board member of SF CASA and also a foster parent. Thank you to all of our guests tonight. Thank you for being here and supporting our work at SF CASA. Without you, none of this would be possible. Thank you, and have a wonderful evening.
Hi, I'm Caroline Bergsma, a board member at SF CASA. I want to thank our friends and family for gathering tonight to celebrate this amazing organization and support our foster youth. Cheers.
Hi, I'm Brooke. I'm an SF CASA board member, and I just want to say thank you so much to everyone who's joined us tonight. We truly couldn't do this without your support. Here's to a wonderful evening.
Our amazing board, it takes a village, it takes an awesome board, and they have been incredible. They helped get us to this moment, this abundant moment tonight, this abundant moment of giving. And I'm bursting with joy because I'm looking at this. We are so close to 800,000. The generosity of all of you watching at home tonight, and the giving keeps on coming. Kunal Gandhi, Kunal, thank you for your gift of $1,000. Make some noise in the room, everybody. Come on, here we go. Also want to thank Shirin. Thank you, Shirin, so very much for your gift of $250. We thank you. To Margaret, we thank you, Margaret, for your gift of $1,000. And then to Verna Kuo, thank you, Verna, for your gift of $1,000. Every donation matters, friends. And the great thing is, every single dollar you give is going to go directly to us funding more CASAs for our foster youth. That's why we're here tonight. And we appreciate everything everyone is giving. A big shout out to Judy Donovelle, a gift of $2,500. Come on, let's hear it for Judy. We thank you. We thank you so very, very much. Friends, we said at the beginning of this night, as the thermometer rises, we're so close to our goal. This is exciting. Every donation matters. And whether you give $10, $20, $1,000, $10,000, whatever you can give, just give from the heart. If it feels good, make that contribution. If you're already given, thank you. But if you want to have a little bit of fun and you love your champagne, I'm going to invite you to jump in for this last little speed round of giving. So here's the deal, friends. We have this glorious magnum of Pierre Moncrieff, one of my favorite champagnes from France. And so you can jump in the next few minutes. There's the bubbles, real bubbles, by the way, the real bubbles in here. Whatever you can give, minimum $100 right here, right now. And if you can make a donation in the next 5 minutes, we're going to pick someone at random, and then we're going to send this to you in the week, all right? So get giving, friends. You know how to do it. Hit the donate button. If you're already given, thank you. But for the next few minutes, everyone who gives in the next few minutes, you will be put into this champagne giveaway, and we will pick one lucky person. You have until midnight tonight also to bid on all those items. So there we go, $100 donation, and one lucky person will get the magnum of champagne. Lauren Perrier is on vacation, so Pierre Moncrieff jumped in instead. It's just as good, just as bubbly. All right, so friends, let's get giving this last little speed round. And then let me remind you, you do have until midnight tonight to bid on the auction items. So please take your time, but please know by midnight we're going to cut everything off. So you want to get in, bid high, bid for the trip, bid for that massive 9-liter bottle of wine. You deserve it. I know you want it. But now we have another important story to share. So friends, please take a look. Roll the video.
My name is Michael. I am a lawyer. I've lived in California for about 25 years. I'm married, no kids. A good friend of mine, Tina, was a CASA and was on the CASA board here in California, and she recommended it to me, actually. She thought that it would be a good fit for me, a good use of my advocacy skills. You know, right now with COVID, the situation's even more difficult, particularly for my youth. He's very isolated in a small apartment. Every week, I meet with him a couple times, and recently, on the weekends, we go to the beach. And when I'm out there with him, I just see this kid really being a kid and having fun, you know, which kids should have, right? My youth likes penguins. And he just he's really into penguins. And a few weeks ago, I took him to the zoo, and he was the first time he's ever been to a zoo. First time he's ever seen a penguin live. And there are like hundreds of them out that day at the zoo. And it was just a whole nother world for him. I mean, and he wrote a report on it for one of his classes. That's the type of connections that you don't realize you can build. I'm also working with him very closely with his school. I'm his educational rights holder. I'm in touch with all of his teachers. We work hand in hand with him. He passed all of his classes last semester, which was the first time he's done that in a couple years. He's so excited about school, I think in part because he has someone who actually cares about what he's doing in school. Just last week, he was so excited because he got an A on a biology test. And it just meant the world to him. And I remember driving up to his apartment and he ran out with the paper waving it at me. He was just so excited. And I think in part because someone cares. There's a big impact on the community itself. You know, a lot of these kids, if they don't get CASA or don't get the help that they need early on, their future's not bright for them for a lot of reasons. But I realize, and I can see it in my relationship with my youth, that his direction in his life might have changed for the better, and hopefully it will. And that's a huge impact just on the community overall, to be focused on these kids and helping them you know, become productive, healthy, happy citizens, you know. The training through CASA is so impressive, so comprehensive, that they're really gonna cover a lot of the areas that you might have a lot of questions about. The support, the staff, the people that I interact with, if I have questions, are always there for me. So the organization as a whole, it just runs so well, and there's always the support you need if you need it. There's always someone there to reach out to. It's challenging, I would say. It's a big commitment. But the payoffs are huge. They have been for me. And that's just been a huge surprise for me, how big the payoff is. Just actually start seeing the impact in my youth's life. It's just worth the commitment. You know, I must say my kid inspires me the most. Here is a youth who has more challenges in his life than probably a lot of us will in our entire lives. And he's just a young kid. And I'm helping him face those challenges. I'm helping him as much as I can. But he's doing a lot on his own, and it's extremely inspiring to me to see how much potential he has and how he's reacted to our relationship. A couple weeks ago, he came running out to the car when I went to pick him up to go to the beach, and he had a card that he gave me, and I just wanted to read it to you. It says on the front, "Sometimes it helps just to know someone cares. Thank you for everything you do for me." And so for me, that just sums it up completely.
Another wonderful story reminding us why we're all gathered here together tonight for this San Francisco CASA event. You've all been so incredibly generous. I'm going to get out of the way so we can look at that totalizer in just a moment. But the winner of the Magnum, the Pierre Moncui, is Katie Barnes. Katie, congratulations. We're going to get this to you. This will be on your doorstep in the week. Let's hear it for Katie. Yes, hear it for Katie. And by the way, the generosity abound tonight. Good news is nobody's going to be charged until Monday. However, if you don't want your credit card to be charged, you can pay another way. All you have to do is email Maggie, and that's our Maggie, maggie@sfcasa.org. That's maggie@sfcasa.org. Friends, it has been an extraordinary evening. I'm giving you all a big hug of love for your generosity and your giving. You did this tonight for our foster youth. As we welcome in our fearless leader, Kate, what a night. Can we raise a glass?
What a night. Yes, we can.
Well,
thank you.
Should we have a little look to see how we've done?
Yes, we shall.
We are so close, friends. We are so incredibly close. And I want to remind people, Kate, you can actually give until midnight tonight. You can also, we can give any time, but you can bid on the auction items. I know you want a vacation, right? You'd like one. You deserve one, Kate. So you can bid on the auction items till midnight tonight. Just hit that donate button because we want to blast through that $800,000 goal. Big giving hearts. They did it, Kate, and cheers to you.
Cheers, and thank you all so much for a spectacular evening. I understand we raised as much tonight as we did at our last live event.
Make some noise, everybody. Come on.
Woo! I want to especially thank our speakers tonight, Veronica, Maria, and Mike, and also thank the team behind the scenes, Paul
the
and A-team. Maggie. And I want to thank all of you for your incredible generosity. Thank you. Thank you so much. And have a good night.
Cheers. Hopefully in person next year.
Yes.
Cheers, Kate.
Cheers.
Cheers. For our foster youth.